Thanks for joining me, Winston. We were chatting at a talk that you gave in December of 2019, where you were talking about some of the challenges that you face when engaging with people, having conversations with people, when people don't think about, you know, for us as able-bodied people, we don't think about the challenges others might face in having simple conversations and building professional relationships. So I wonder if you can share some of the issues that come your way in just building strong professional relationships with people around you who may not have similar challenges.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Andy. And I think for me, obviously, the obvious challenge is because I'm a wheelchair user. There is always, if we start at the sort of first point of contact, which is when I would meet somebody for the first time. So I've just brought into a meeting room. There's five or six people in there already. And, you know, it's that, you know, hey, I'm Winston moment. And then you often have this, I guess you could call it a deadlock, where people don't really know how to respond to me in the first instance because I look so different to what they're used to. And so a challenge in that scenario would be, you know, somebody starts second guessing themselves. Can I shake Winston's hand? Should I stand up? Should I come down to his level? And then you have this almost manufactured awkwardness that happens where we're both in limbo. So I know he or she is overthinking it. And I'm kind of here waiting for them to make up their minds. And so we're kind of like in this deadlock, like I say. And so for me, what I found useful in those moments is, you know, just go for it. You know, if for you, Andy, the way you greet people is to shake their hand, then just put out your hand and shake Winston's hand. If for some reason, myself or another disabled person or less able person is not able to shake hands, then you'll find out soon enough, right? Either they'll tell you, or you'll just have to figure out another way to greet. So that's one tip that I've come across.
I'm not quite sure we'll be able to shake hands with anyone after this lockdown. but it's good advice. I heard a number of years ago now, I'll admit, going back quite a while, I really struggled with that awkwardness. And I still do occasionally. You know, we're so attuned to engaging with people in a way that we expect that as soon as someone is in a different position and it's out of the norm, we don't automatically know how to behave. And it's very easy to hide away and go and talk to other people instead. And I was taught years ago, no, you know, if someone's in a wheelchair, you don't talk to the person pushing them, you talk to them in the same way. And it's just so simple, but I found that, you know, very effective advice. Do you find that there's been an improvement in the way people engage as we've been more aware of inclusion? Or do you still find most people struggle?
I feel like the approach that I've decided to take, Andy, is to be more proactive with it. So I no longer wait for people to have this deadlock moment and then decide how they're going to, you know, communicate with me. I'll be the one to put my hand out to shake yours. I'll make the decision for them in a way. Because I guess, like you say, we all have our, I don't know if it's unconscious bias, if that's the right term, and I have it too. So I've had situations where I've had to, when I was working in corporate, I worked with a visually impaired person. He couldn't see at all. So, and he was sitting pretty much next to me. So every day I had this, you know, my own deadlock where it was kind of like, you know, how do I, you know, I want to ask Paul something, but I don't even know, should I tap him on the shoulder? Should I just speak? So for me, what's really helped is being proactive in communicating my needs. And so I'm not even saying that the responsibility is with the able person or the less able person. It's the responsibility is in the communication itself from both parties to meet in the middle, because we all have these biases within us.
So when you delivered the presentation, you talked about how difficult it is for you to build a network and that your network is perhaps naturally much smaller than an able-bodied person's might be. Now that's not right. That's not what, you know, if you are quite able to engage from your perspective with other people, then there's nothing that should stop you having that strong network. So what is it that I can do and other people can do to make sure that we are as inclusive as possible and we allow everyone the opportunity to build as many strong relationships as they need to.
Yeah, that's a good point. And I think just to add a bit of context, so I was speaking about social capital. So the idea that, you know, the average person has a certain number, I think the number was 150, of what you could say are casual friendships, casual relationships, right? People that they may be able to reach out to for various things if they need to, whether it's professionally or personally. And the same study showed that the average disabled person has around 25 of those relationships. And I was trying to understand why there was that discrepancy. And I guess there's a lot of, physical justifications for it as well. So, you know, using my own example, you know, I couldn't get out, for example, to the playground as much as, you know, my friends in the same year group could, right, when I was younger. So whereas they might go to the playground, I don't know, every day probably, when we were younger, I could probably get out, you know, once or twice a week. And that's if I had someone to come with me and, you know, it really had to be planned. Whereas for my peers, it was just popping out. And then the same thing in a grown-up situation, right? You know, for me, moving around London, which is where I live, using public transport is a bit of a nightmare. It needs a lot of planning. You know, even any mode of transport, you know, flying, etc. I'm required to do a lot more planning than the average person. And so with the limited movement comes limited opportunities to interact with other people and to nurture those relationships. So I think that's been one of the things that's contributed to that number, although there are many others. And how can somebody help? So as an employer, is to get the basics right, to have good access to your building so that I don't have to not come to your networking event or not come to your, you know, whatever conference you're hosting because I can't get up a big flight of stairs. So once you start to get those basic tactical things right, then it literally opens the door, physically opens the door to people like me being able to come into that room and then try and build those relationships.
The number, the 150 you talked about, is the Dunbar number, which is, you know, how many people we can remember at any one time. One of the things that I talk about is that when people talk about the size of a network, and they use the Dunbar number very often, or Girard's law, which is 250, as an indicator, you mentioned it earlier, that can include a lot of casual contacts, whereas a strong relationship building strategy is about deepening the relationships. You use the term nurture them. So it's not actually just about the events and conferences, is it? But it's about people thinking, you know, if we're going to organize drinks, are we able to invite Winston along or whoever that might be? And to involve people who do have access challenges in everything that they do. Do you think that social media has improved your opportunities to nurture those relationships? And, you know, when we're recording this, we're going through the lockdown, you know, and everyone's suddenly using Zoom all of the time. I've got a Zoom quiz night tonight. Has that shifted the landscape for you a little bit? And is that something you would look to use more going forward and you think people are more available to? Or do you think that's too much almost of an easy alternative?
Yeah, so I have maybe a bit of a bias towards digital because I'm basically a computer science graduate and I was a programmer for 10 years. So, you know, I was probably one of the first 1,000 people to use Zoom many, many years ago. Yeah. So I think for me, digital is a good thing. Of course, there's two sides to every argument, but I know, like, even in this time that we're in lockdown, one of the things that has really been useful for me is to even drop an email or do a phone call to people that I've worked with professionally, but also to my friends and just have it as a way of reaching out with no agenda, right? So I'm just reaching out to check in on you, Andy. How are you doing? You know, how are you coping in these unprecedented times? And, you know, that's something that I think is valid, whether you're, you know, able or less able, et cetera. Because social media is just a tool, and just like any other tool, you can use it for, well, for whatever shapes and purposes you choose to. And can it be used to build and nurture relationships? 100%.
And I mean, this is advice that I'm giving all of the time, is just reach out to people and don't always make it transactional. You know, make it about just checking in, particularly while we're on lockdown. But I think it's generally good advice. Yes. But for someone who can't get to every drinks meeting, every dinner or lunch, whatever it might be, for someone who that amount of planning is involved, or they might need someone with them to support them, then involving people virtually could be an option as well, although not the only one.
Yeah, it's a good option to have, although there's the other side of it, I guess, is it can also create like a FOMO, like a fear of missing out. Yeah. So, you know, if the only way you get to connect with people is mostly digital, and, you know, I'm aware that, you know, Andy and, you know, everyone, they go for drinks every Thursday, there'll still be that sense of I'm missing out. And so it's how to balance that. So maybe another way to be inclusive is to have a mix of, if you know some people are only able to interact digitally, for example, is to just have that balance of digital versus live get-togethers, right? So that if I'm one of those digital people, then, you know, I'm catered for as well. And it's pretty much in the same way that, you know, if your thing is to go out for a steak every week or for beers every week, just to think about the vegetarians in the group, or, you know, the people who have different religious things that stop them drinking and stuff like that. So it's how do you make it more holistically inclusive?
So it's just about awareness and consciousness, and just thinking about other people, whether it's when you first meet someone and they may seem different to you in some way, just treating them like an ordinary human being, because that's what they are, or whether it's people that you know and like and perhaps take for granted a little bit, and just remembering that they might not always voice it, but they might appreciate you thinking about them when you make your plans.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. And I think the other thing that triggers for me is thinking about psychological safety, which is the making people feel safe to express what they need. Because remember earlier, I talked about this communication that needs to be two-way. But the only way, or to make it easier for somebody to be open with what they need to feel safe and not feel like they might be judged. So I've been in situations, for example, in the office, and I think this happens all the time, when it's, hey guys, let's go for drinks, it's Thursday. And someone says, oh, you know, I'm not drinking this week or this month or whatever, for Lent or whatever reason. And then they become a bit of a butt of the jokes, right? And so what that creates, even though it's being said in a humorous way, it actually takes away the psychological safety for that person. And then they stop communicating their needs if this carries on. And so you have a situation where they become less and less connected to the group. And the group isn't even aware, because, you know, this thing that was being said in jest is actually having a much more detrimental effect. So just to be aware of the kind of conversations, and because different people will respond differently to humor and banter.
Winston, thank you very much. And I hope that's useful for everyone. And there's some really good advice there.
Thanks, Andy. Thanks for having me.